Hey guys, what's up? It's Alex over at Laser Everything, and so many of you are frustrated by this one thing with your fiber lasers, and that's how to deal with powder-coated metals on the fiber laser, right? We just need to keep up with those guys on the CO2. If the guys on the CO2 are able to do it, I should be able to do it too with my fancy fiber laser, right? Well, you can, and it's not that difficult. So we're gonna teach you how to get results exactly like this, no problem whatsoever, and we're getting started right now. All right, guys, I hope you're excited because it's time to do a real tumbler with the fiber laser. We're doing it. I swear to God, this is going to come out so cool. It's going to blow your mind. So all we need to do to get started is set up our rotary tool. That's the important thing here. If you haven't already figured out how to set up your rotary tool, don't worry. We've got a whole video on it. I will throw a link right up here for you so that you guys can check that out. It walks you through everything you need to know to get your rotary tool set up. That said, this tutorial does assume that you already have your rotary system set up and kind of dialed in. So go watch that video first and then come back here and pick up on this one, because this is going to take you the rest of the way for doing powder coated tumblers. So we're going to start with this 20 ounce Arctic tumbler right here. And if we have time, we'll move on to a couple different kinds of things just to test it across different powder coats and things. But it seems to be, from my testing, a pretty universal setup. So let's go ahead and we'll set this aside for just a minute, and we're gonna go throw our rotary tool on the actual engraving bed. So let's go take care of that right now. I also just want to point out that part of the trick of this is using the largest lens you can, because the larger the lens, the bigger the dot size. Now, the largest lens I have is the 220 millimeter lens, but the focal distance is too great, so I actually max out my tower before I can get the rotary tool and tumbler underneath the 220. So I just don't have enough height on my tower in order to use this lens. So instead of using the 220, we're gonna have to use the 150. So we'll reach into the lens bag here and we'll grab the 150. This is the one that's going on. So just use the biggest lens that you can actually get away with on your tower height. It's probably gonna be around 150 millimeters because the rotary tool and the tumbler sit pretty high up already. So you're adding that on top of your longest focal distance lens. It's probably going to be taller than your tower is actually going to be able to go, unless you have one of those crazy 800 millimeter towers. You know, something like the 150 is going to have to do, but that's okay because that's what we've developed the settings for. Next up, we want to get our cup onto the rotary tool. When we do this, just make sure that it's flush against all of the jaws of the chuck all the way around. So once we actually get it on, you're going to spin it. You'll see here in a second, we're going to spin it just to make sure that it's flush against all of the jaws. You'll also kind of see I'm putting pressure on the bottom of the cup to keep pressure on the jaw that's facing the ground, because our rotary tool, the jaws just hit their limit just as it's starting to put pressure on the cup, and we don't want the jaws to start slipping out towards the floor. So I'm keeping pressure on the bottom of the cup in order to keep that jaw in place as we expand the jaws into the tumbler. So after you're done with that, just check them, make sure they're all flush, and you're good to move on to the next step. Finally, it's time to focus. We're actually going to be defocusing our laser quite a bit today. 5.5 millimeters, in fact. That's a pretty big defocus. We're defocusing away from the cup, and we're just going to use these two spacers here. It's just two cardboard chips that I have laying around using for jigging and things like that. But when put together, they add up to about 5.5 millimeters. So we're going to place those on the cup and then focus to those spacers, and that will give us a nice even 5.5 millimeter defocusing distance. After we're done defocusing, we also just want to make sure that we are level with the head. So if you don't know, you don't level to ground, you're going to level to the head. First, you're going to take the level and put it on the head of the machine and just see where the bubble falls. And then your goal is to match the leveling with the cup. So after that, you'll take the level, you'll place it on the cup. And then you're just going to adjust the cup until it's nice and level with the head of your machine. It's pretty straightforward and simple to do. If you need to, for some reason, adjust the leveling on the cup, these two little screws right in the back of your rotary tool, if you have one similar to mine, will allow you to make that adjustment. So you can find those here. That was a lot of setup, and I'm going to explain to you why we have to do this. Now, if you're using something like a CO2, you don't really have to take all of these different precautions and make all of these adjustments like defocusing and using big lenses. And that's because when a CO2 laser engraves something like one of these powder-coated tumblers, the wavelength of a CO2 laser beam is perfect for removing paint, but actually can't mark the metal. So you don't have to worry about what the laser is going to do after the paint has been burned away. With something like the fiber laser, the fiber is designed to mark metal. So what's going to happen is the fiber laser is going to come down, it's going to burn away the paint, and then it's going to mark the metal underneath the paint. What we're trying to do by making these adjustments is weaken the beam to the point where it can actually remove the powder coat from the tumbler without marking the steel underneath. By the time it gets to the steel, it just won't be powerful enough to leave a mark, and we'll have that nice, clean, stainless, brushed finish left there, just like we would expect from a CO2 laser. So that's what we're doing. All of these different adjustments that we're making are to increase our dot size. When you have a bigger laser dot size, it's weaker because it's spreading the same amount of power out over a larger area. So when we defocus, the more defocused you are, the larger your dot size gets, right? When we use a larger lens, like we're using the 150 on purpose here, because the 150 is going to have a much larger dot size than something like a 110 or a 70, right? We want the biggest dot size possible. That's going to give us a nice clean mark, removing the powder coat without actually having enough energy density to mark the metal. So that's why we're making these adjustments. But we kind of got off on a sidetrack there. We have defocused the laser. We have made sure that everything is nice and level, so we get a nice even defocused dot across the whole thing. We've put in our large lens, and everything is set up and ready to go. So with all of that done, we're going to go ahead and jump into EasyCAD so we can talk about what some of the final steps are before we start marking our tumbler. So we'll go ahead and just launch our 150mm lens copy of EasyCAD 2. So here we are with a blank workspace, and the first thing that we're really going to want to do here is just go ahead and draw a line. We're going to draw a line straight across the middle. We kind of cover this in the rotary setup video, but we just want to make sure that our cup is nice and aligned with the center axis here. All we need to do this is hit the red light button, and this is going to project that red line onto our cup, and we're going to move the line up or down with our keyboard until it's right in the middle of the cup. This is also a good time if you need to align something to the middle of an existing logo on the tumbler to do that as well. This is a great time to take care of that too. So you can go ahead and rotate the stepper motor till you get it right in the center and everything is nice and straight by moving that line up and down, and we'll be good to go. You'll also notice at the end there, I turned off the power to the stepper motor to have finer control over where the bottle was. Then when I had it where I wanted it to be, I turned the power to the stepper back on and it snapped back into place and we were good to go. If you don't have a switch on an external controller like I do, you can simply unplug it from the laser machine and that'll do the same thing. But yeah, just don't have power running to the stepper motors. Otherwise, it's going to take those huge steps. It's going to be really hard to get things centered. So it's best to do your alignment with the stepper motor unplugged. All right, guys, I'm nice and happy with this, actually. Our laser line here is not perfectly in the center of the Yeti, but it is perfectly centered with where we focus to, and that's what really matters here. So with that done, we can go ahead and remove that and bring in our artwork. This is laser everything, guys, so you know we're going to do a laser everything logo, and once we bring it in, we just want to make sure that the top of our artwork is facing the top of our cup, and all we need to do is go ahead and hit the light button, and we're going to take a look at that. Over here on the tumbler, we just want to make sure that things are sized right. We want to make sure that everything looks good. The lighting function in Rotary Mark is actually going to show us the starting point of the mark, not where the overall graphic is going to fall. So red lighting in 2D non-rotary mode is still the best way to get a good idea of where your mark's going to fall. I really like the way this looks. I'm super happy with that. So we can go ahead and stop lighting here, and it's time to do our hatch. So we'll go ahead and hatch here. Our line distance 0.02 is working really well for me right now. And we have one hatch. It's a 0-degree hatch. There's no cross hatch. And we do want to make sure that we turn off mark contour, because this is not compatible in any way with rotary mark. So we don't want to follow edge once. We don't want to mark contour. Both of those are going to cause problems. As you can see, hatch 2 and 3 are both disabled. So hatch 1 is the only one that we've got going on right now. And everything in this looks great. So we'll go ahead and hit OK. Now, our 0-degree hatch, the reason we're using that, if we zoom in, is you can see that the lines are actually moving up and down. And this is the same orientation as our bottle is turning. We don't want our hatches moving left and right from the perspective of the graphic, because if they're moving that way, what's going to happen is it's just going to do little blips as it tries to get the line all the way across the bottle. Not only is it going to slow you down, it doesn't look very nice. So we want to make sure that our graphic lines here for our hatch are moving in the same direction that the cup is sitting. In this case, the top of our cup is over here on the left, the bottom of our cup is over here on the right, and those are the directions that our lines are moving. So that looks really good as well. Last but not least, we need a parameter, right? We need a setting. So we'll come over here to use default param, and we'll uncheck that. We're going to select a parameter from the library. We're going to scroll down. It took me a long time to make this setting right here, F powder coated tumblers, right? This was a tough one, but we got it. It's right here, and it's Rakus friendly. So all you Rakus guys out there, you're gonna be happy campers. We've got a speed of 750, a power of 80, and a frequency of 80, and that's gonna get the job done. So you don't need a super high frequency for this. If you remember our Yeti Dog Bowl video, we actually used a super high frequency in order to limit the power. But in this case, since we're using the rotary, we actually don't need to do that, because we can defocus further with the rotary than we can when we're trying to project an image around an item. So with that said, 750, 80, 80, we're good to go. Everything looks great here, so let's go ahead and hop into rotary mark. When the plugin loads up, we're going to see some options here. We can uncheck force all split. We don't need that because we are marking by split size, which we've got right here. For this case, we're going to match our split size to our line distance, so that's 0.2. If you want it to go faster, you can raise your split size. I recommend multiples of your line distance, so 0.02, 0.04, 0.06, right, et cetera, et cetera. But 0.02 is going to work great for us. And if you have questions about some of the other stuff going on in here, definitely check out the rotary setup video. The only other thing you should have to manage here is the part diameter. That's the actual diameter of the tumbler. Ours is 91 millimeters. I've measured it in advance. And your focal length. This is the actual focal length of your laser. So this would be like the distance that your focal stick covers, not the focal distance printed on the lens. The one on the lens is not accurate and it'll mess up the math. So don't use that one. Use your actual focal distance for this field right here. With those two set up, we're good to go. We're ready to start marking. We've done everything we need to do. So without further ado, let's hop over to EasyCAD and hit F2. To clean this bad boy, we're gonna do the typical laser everything combo, 99% alcohol, and then we're gonna shine it up with a little bit of Zep. Just to show you the before, there it is. It's looking pretty dirty, pretty rough there, but we're gonna clean this up, no problem. So really quick, let's just grab our magic eraser right there. This one's pretty beat up, but we've still got a little bit of life in it. And we're just gonna get a quick dab. And we're gonna give it a very, very gentle kind of scrub down here. And last but not least, we're just gonna hit it with a little bit of Zep. And here it is, guys, the final result for you. We'll go ahead and zoom in on that so that you can see. We have a perfectly engraved tumbler. Absolutely no problems with that at all. That's looking really, really nice. We've got that perfect brushed steel shine under there, just like you're used to from anything else, you know, like a CO2 laser. That's going to be working perfectly. Seriously, guys, I mean, you really cannot hope for better than this on a fiber laser. You just can't. That's the perfect mark. And so, it's just excellent. honestly, it's just so sharp and clean, and it just looks amazing. So hopefully that helps you guys out. Just to illustrate that this works on multiple different things, we'll go ahead and try the same thing on a Yeti mug, and I'm going to just jump right into it. We're just going to run it right away. Same steps, a little bit of a different diameter, but the same exact steps. Let's test these settings on something different. So I've just adjusted our positioning and our leveling a little bit here. And if we come over into EasyCAD, if we look up in the rotary mark section here, we do just want to adjust our part diameter. So for these, it's about 102 millimeters. So we'll go ahead and type 102 millimeters in and we'll hit OK. And that's it. With that done, we can go ahead and we can mark this one too. Let's check it out. And we're gonna do the same exact cleaning process here, just a little bit of alcohol. I went ahead and cut off the nasty bits from the magic eraser there, because it was getting a little gross. But we'll go ahead and we're just gonna give this a quick scrub. And we're gonna finish it off with a little bit of Zep. And that's another flawless victory right there for the fiber laser marking something powder coated. Look at that. Just excellent results. I mean, really, really great. Again, about as good as you could ever hope to do with a fiber laser. It didn't mark the metal at all. It's just super duper clean. That's what we want right there. And again, here is the Arctic tumbler. Looking really shiny and nice as well. So despite differences in powder coating, the measures that we took to make sure we weren't going to mark the metal have been super effective. There just isn't enough energy in the beam to leave a lasting mark on these metal cups. It can only get rid of the powder coat, and that is why we're defocusing. That is why we're setting that frequency to about 80. That's why we're using the largest lens we can use, because it eliminates having to worry about the fiber laser actually marking the metal. And the results speak for themselves, guys. Check those out. Okay, so you're still skeptical. You don't quite believe in the black magic yet. Well, let me show you this. Some people might be asking, what about the really thin, almost like painted powder coated stuff like the pint glasses? Well, we did one of those too, and this one didn't even require cleaning. It just came out perfectly the first time. That's just straight off the laser there. Here is a quick clip of it running for you. And all we had to do to get this one to come out was just take our measurement for our diameter in the center, because this one does have a little bit more of a slope to it than some of the other things that we've engraved tonight. And we went ahead and applied that new diameter to our part diameter field right here. That's it. I didn't do anything else to the file. I didn't change the settings at all. It just came out perfectly the first time. There it is again. Another look for you. So we've done the thin pint glass, painted powder coat style thing. We've done an Arctic tumbler right there. Check out that super clean sheen. And finally, we have done a Yeti, and it works perfectly with all three of these powder coat jobs. No problem whatsoever. I can't stress this enough. The trick to doing this is just to make the beam weak enough that it can't actually ablate the metal. That way it's only got enough power to remove the powder coat and paint on these items. Once you figure that out, the rest is super duper easy. I really hope that this tutorial helped you guys out big time. I've been meaning to make this episode forever. I get so many questions about this on a daily basis. You know, while this is super effective, CO2 is always going to be better, right? Because we don't have to mess around with like weird settings and defocusing. The CO2 is already too weak to mark the metal. So it does all of that work for us, and we can just engrave it like we engrave anything else. But I know a lot of you guys don't have the money for a CO2 laser. A lot of you guys bought a fiber, that's the money you had, and that was the one laser you could get, and you can't go out and get another laser right now, and you're looking for an effective solution to keep up with those CO2 guys. This is it. This is the trick right here. This is the ticket. So I really hope that this helped you guys out. That said, you guys can totally handle this. I have complete faith in you. I hope you got value out of this video. If you did, don't forget to smash the like button. Let everybody else know that the content is amazing. And don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you get notified the next time I post a video. I think next time we're going to be messing around with steel tumblers and the Z Mark, so you definitely don't want to miss that. And don't forget to sign up for the Laser Master Academy. I'm going to have this setting along with all of my other settings for my CO2 and fiber laser library ready to go with the spreadsheet converter so you can convert them for your laser and your lens. Not to mention, you get hours and hours of bonus live stream content. We just shot a new one yesterday. We just do a bunch of different jobs in the shop. You get real world experience working with the lasers, and bonus episodes of the podcast. Not to mention, you're supporting the show, you're supporting the channel, and it's the reason that I get to continue making these videos. So definitely don't skip on that. You can check it out at masters.lasereverything.net. And while you're at it, if you can't support the show right now, you're just not in the cards, go check out our free Discord server. That's linked down in the description below, right next to the link to the Laser Master Academy. It's our amazing online community. It's got over 1,700 members. They're excited to talk to you. They want to see what you're working on. They want to help you with your problems. Everybody there really works together. There's an amazing sense of camaraderie with other people that are doing the same thing as you. So check out the Discord too. And I think that's it, guys. Thank you so much for watching this episode. Seriously, I'm so excited to present this one to you. And you know, I mean, just look at that, guys. I mean, that's sick. It's sick. This is super legit. This is unreal. So I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I will see you in the next one. We'll be right back.